Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to another episode of Finding Me on the ITV Networks. When you do things from your soul, you feel a river flowing inside of you or moving in you. You feel a sense of joy. And this sense of joy and this feeling usually comes when you sit in a discussion with a very special guest that I have with me today. And although the focus of this show has been to give women a platform to discuss some of their experiences and identities as Western Muslims, today it is necessary to acknowledge the others who play a significant role in educating women on their true Islamic identity. My special guest today is Professor Tariq Ramadan, who needs actually very little introduction. Tariq Ramadan is in South Africa as a special guest lecturer of the University of Pretoria. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Professor, and welcome.
Wa alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Professor, we have a lot of questions, so I would like to get right into it. And the first one that I would like to address to you is that the message that often stems from many of your books and your talks, in it is evident that you feel that Muslims actually have, Western Muslims have an identity problem. Can you elaborate on this?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Yes, I think that having studied the situation of Muslims in the West over the last 30 years, what is clear is that there is an identity crisis, starting with the relationship between the Islamic principles and the cultures of origin, and the cultures that are coming from Africa, North African countries, patriarchal cultures. And they have this problem, which is what relates to the principles of Islam, what is very really Islamic, and what is cultural. And this is the first problem. The second one has to do with the way they are perceived as alien to the Western culture, alien to the European culture. So they tend to have a defensive attitude, and this is a symptom of a crisis where you are on the defensive. When you define yourself against but not define yourself from within, in the intrinsic dimension of your identity. So these are two phenomenon that are explaining. There are deeper things, but it will take a long time to explain.
I think then it relates to what you've mentioned before, where you speak of a self-alienation within the Muslims.
Yes, but the starting point before being self-alienation is very much about the lack of knowledge. Very much about the lack of knowledge. If you know, you come from families that experience economic exile because they were trying to survive coming to Europe and coming to the West, it's clear that the parents didn't have a strong Islamic background, and for them to be a good Muslim meant to be a Muslim as we were in the countries of origin. And for the young generations, yes, to question this. In fact, to be a good Muslim doesn't mean to be an Algerian Muslim in France, or a Pakistani Muslim in Britain, or a Turkish Muslim in Germany. It means to be a Muslim relying on principles and being able to be open to cultures. The universality of Islam is very much this, is the universal principles accepting and acknowledging a diversity of cultures. So there is a diversity of cultures that we have to take into account, and European cultures or South African cultures or African cultures are cultures that we can integrate as long as we are knowledgeable about our principles. And then comes the possible or potential alienation, is that when you define yourself through the eyes of the others. So this is where you become and you make yourself the object of the perception and not the subject of your definition.
And that it becomes complex for them as well, and they totally, okay. So is it haram then to be a Muslim and have a South African or a Western identity? And are these two concepts irreconcilable, or can they work for you?
I think that it's even a wrong question and a wrong way of dealing with it. You cannot be but a South African Muslim and a Western Muslim when you live in the West. Now, what is important is to know that when we speak about South African Islam or European Islam or Western Islam, we are not saying that there are many Islams. We are saying there is one Islam as to the principles dealing with a diversity of cultures. So South African Muslims are Muslims by principle and South African by culture, and there is nothing wrong. What is important is, in the light of the principles, to take what is good from the respective cultures. So what we are in every specific culture is the added ethical value dealing with the culture to reform the cultures for the better. So not everything in the South African culture is good, not everything in the Arab culture is good. We need to reform in the light of our principles. But to do this, you need to have knowledge and confidence. It's just to look and to say, you know, what is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ said, which is so important, الْحِكْمَةُ ضَلَّةُ الْمُسْلِمِ فَهُوَ أَوْلَى بِهَا أَيْنَمَا وَجَدَهَا. So the last property of the Muslim is to look for. It's not only to accept the culture, it's to be curious. It's to have this sense of curiosity towards your own culture and to say, I want to know what is it all about, and I will take from arts and imagination and sense of humor as well.
And it's good that you're raising these issues, because at the same time it relates to a sense of understanding and education. And of course, very often I've heard you mention that you speak about emancipation of women, and you say it should be on two levels, one in terms of education and the second one in terms of equity or justice in the workplace. But how would you then respond to those who say that females should not get educated or should not attend public schools or secular institutions such as universities, that it's better that they stay at home, have a home education, that women should have home-based industries, etc.? Because this view is espoused or adopted by many women, and as a result, females are held back.
I think it's very much a question of understanding the scriptural sources and understanding the context. When you have a hadith, a prophetic tradition saying, طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم ومسلمة, that seeking knowledge is an obligation for all Muslim men and women, that's the starting point of everything, that you have to be knowledgeable, so you have to be educated.
Yeah, but can I just stop you there? Because the distinction then comes when the Prophet ﷺ said, which is what is then taught to the Muslim public, is that he meant only Islamic knowledge, that you should not get...
No, but how can they say Islamic knowledge?
But it's the qualification that is usually...
So that's wrong. Yeah. It's knowledge. And in Islam, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ, the people who are the more God-conscious are the people who are knowledgeable. It's not, there is no qualification, and they have no right to qualify this. And by the way, the people who have this very literalist approach and sometimes distorted approach of some scriptural sources, they don't even want the women to have religious knowledge, because it might be that the religious knowledge, they are going to challenge them in the way they are reading some of the scriptural sources in the Quran and the Sunnah. So I would say here that to get knowledge and to be able to have a kind of autonomy, this was the case of Khadija radiallahu anha, and this was the case of Aisha. Aisha was a alima, she was a great mind, and Khadija was autonomous, and she was the Prophet's wife, alayhi salam. So we need to get this understanding that today, to get knowledge, to be able also to be active within the society, it's so important for two reasons. First, because this is Islamic, and the second, because there is the contextual reality. So if you are isolated at home and you have your kids going to schools, they will come back to you, and if you don't know anything about the society, what is it going to be? How are you going to educate them? You can't educate in isolation. You educate in an environment. So you have to be knowledgeable. So all the people are saying, you are a woman, you are a mother, you stay at home and you educate our kids. For which society? In which environment? So there is a contradiction in terms here. And it might be that the people who are saying this might think about the role of men in the whole educational process. They might be much more involved as opposed to ask the woman to be the only involved.
Yeah, and that brings me then to the question, how should Muslims then integrate into their societies? And should they integrate? Because we are often told that we must not integrate, that we are separate and they are separate.
I think that the concept of integration was a good one 50 years ago when the processes of living together started. Now it's over. This discussion is not a choice. There is no option here. You are in a society and you need to do something even more. It's to get a sense of belonging. Remember, even the Prophet ﷺ, when he left Mecca to Medina, what he did is to try to get a sense of the Ansari culture, to make it clear that they belong to this society. And at the end, when they came back to Mecca, he himself came back to Medina, getting this sense of belonging within the Medinian culture. And this is why today South Africa or the Western countries are our countries, and we need to work on the sense of belonging. Sense of belonging in Arabic terms or in Islamic terms and terminology has to do with the well-being, maslahat al-nas, which is the public interest. So the better you feel at home in your environment, the better you are going to be with the Islamic principles. Mm-hmm. The more you don't feel good, the more the principles are perceived as heavy and constraints on you, that you cannot just, it's just something which is separating you from life. So how are you going to understand the call of the Prophet ﷺ saying, Yassiru wa la tu'assiru, make things easy, and bashiru, make things, this is good news. I'm coming with good news. I'm not coming to tell you that you are lost. I'm telling you that not only you are not perfect, but he's ar-Rahman, that Allah is the most merciful. This is good news, and feel good. This is what he said to Hanzala, who thought he was an hypocrite, and he told him, sa'atan fa sa'a ya Hanzala, 1 hour to pray, 1 hour to rest. But you have to rest in order to pray. If you pray all the time, this is not prayer. This is going to be, it's going to be too heavy on you, and you are going to act in a counterproductive way. I think that we need to find this balance. We need to find, but integration, the word itself for me, it's problematic. I'm advocating now a post-integration process, which is not only you are at home in this society, but what you have to do is to come to the other verse of the Quran, which is لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ, in order for we to bear witness to your message before people, you have to contribute. You should be an added value. It's not to integrate, it's to reform for the better. In ethical terms, it's not for the people to become Muslims. Your role is not to convert people. Your role is to be the good witness to your message.
And of course, by default, you're the ambassador to Islam, because every time they look at you, they see a Muslim identity. And so it's, so they must say, what is it appealing about this person?
Yes, you know the way I put exactly what you are saying now, I put it as, be for the people around you like a question. They look at you and say, what is making her or him act in such a way? And let them find the answer.
So added to that, there's a current and predominant discourse, very prevalent in South Africa, that focuses on describing women as a fitna. In most discussions you will see it comes up over and over again. And this is a total opposite message as what was articulated and of course experienced and practiced by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he moved away from the negative aspect of woman to create a positive light of woman as being honored, respected, educated, and of course he supported women in many of their endeavors. So how would you then perhaps understand this particular message that's coming from ulama, South African Muslim ulama, who are going back to this discourse of woman as a fitna as opposed to the understanding of woman as something very positive?
First, there is nothing in the Islamic tradition that is allowing us to go as far as saying women are fitna or they are a problem within the community. We need to understand the reasons why we have this kind of discourse today. First is coming from patriarchal, traditional discourse, the way this was perceived in the countries of origin. It's all about women being responsible within the family. And if now it doesn't work, it means it's coming from women. The status of women as perceived as a secondary class Muslims, and also something which is this kind of perception that they have a lower status, second class Muslims, and not the same status and not the same responsibility. We have to challenge this, But not only by coming back to the scriptural sources, because it's clear that the scriptural sources are giving us a completely different picture of what and how women should be respected within the community. We should try to tackle the problems. And I would say here that it's very important to ask women not to victimize themselves and to come with a deep knowledge of their religion and now to show through their example that they can be at the same time very clear and very faithful as to the principles and active within the society. This is a challenge, but this is it. What we have now is sometimes women in the name of activism losing principles and others in the name of principles forgetting about the society. I think the balance is not the easiest way, you know. The middle pass, ummat and wasata, it's very nice as, you know, a perception, very difficult as implementation. And because isolating yourself, it's even easier. You don't put yourself in any risk or not face any risk. So I think that women should do this. And we also have to come and not to try to go to a struggle between men and women and ask men now, let us be serious about the challenges and the contemporary challenges when it comes to family, when it comes to society. Who now, for example, is doing better when they get access to education? Women, are they doing better? What is happening within family? The absent father. He is only here to come with the authority saying no to things, but not to go along an educational process. What is missing in our families today is not mothers, it's fathers. So this is where we have to come to the problems. And sometimes some are coming back to the scriptural sources and forgetting to look at the problems within the society. And we end up having this superficial discussion about, oh, women are such and such and men are such. I think that it's a question of responsibility, responsabilization in the whole process, and to stop the victim mentality on both sides, so to speak, men and women again, all together.